Kathy, thank you so much for doing this. I'm excited to be here with you. And I'd like to start out just by asking you about the beginning of your career. You're a product manager at Google's Moonshot Factory, Google X. And I was just wondering if you could tell us a little bit about what that experience was like.
It was a really fortunate place to get to build the foundation of my career. I would say that I think sometimes in business, you're sort of trained to be taken seriously. You need to suggest things that are kind of normal, using that word sort of broadly. And Astro, his whole persona is a testament to the fact that that doesn't necessarily have to be the case. And I think the experience of working with so many colleagues that were so brilliant and so accomplished and then encouraged to just think so creatively and not be worried about how they were coming across, it was a really nice thing to have instilled in me at that time.
And actually, going back to that Moonshot Factory, that's where kind of Dandelion traces its origins. It was a Google X project. And I'm just curious, how did you come up with that initial idea? I mean, it's a little different than what Google was doing at the time.
When I was in my position as Rapid Evaluator, which was the title of the people who would look for new ideas to pursue, I focused first on this concept of turning seawater into fuel. It was a project called Foghorn. And we built a prototype with a team at Park. We actually extracted carbon dioxide from seawater. We combined it with hydrogen. We made hydrocarbons. So it was very, I was so inspired by the work. I thought it was very meaningful, but at the same time, it just became incredibly clear as we learned more about the market that cost effectiveness against conventional fuel was decades away. Coming off of that experience, I was really hungry to find an idea or project opportunity that it was just ready. Like the world was ready for it. We could launch it tomorrow and it would just, you know, have this impact that I was really hungry to have on climate. And that's really where heat pumps started capturing my attention. I learned about them first just through this listserv at Google called Energy-Discuss, which is a giant listserv, probably with like tens of thousands of people on it. But a software engineer in the New York office emailed the whole listserv with this very impassioned case for why geothermal heat pumps would be the number one thing that we could look into as a society to combat climate change. And since it was my whole job to figure out that question, what can we look into to combat climate change? It sent me on a journey of really trying to understand how much merit there was to the points he was making. And the thing in the end that really stood out is that all of the incentives looked like they could align. The only barrier was that upfront cost barrier. And the more I learned about that, the more it seemed like, yeah, we could, there's nothing in here that's a showstopper. We can go after this.
So how did you achieve these sort of cost reductions from a technical perspective?
The fundamental reason that geothermal is so high cost is because it's such a niche product. So it's sold in incredibly small volumes. So there's no economies of scale at all and like no investment really in the space. Before Dandelion, there were no drilling techniques or rig suites that were built for geothermal. In the Northeast, everyone was using the same type of rigs that dig water wells. And so you couldn't even fit a water well rig into like half the homes in, for example, Westchester, some of these more suburban environments. And so that's like right off the bat, you're just unable to serve half the market for that one reason, right? And there are just a lot of reasons like that that stack on top of each other. And when you're in that sort of scenario, it becomes very hard to sell the product and very hard to gain any efficiencies installing the product. And so one of the things we did is we created that drilling suite of equipment that could access suburban yards. So that allowed us to serve more than twice as many customers as we could have otherwise.
I wonder, you know, solar is another obviously green energy product that also was fairly niche to begin with. It was unaffordable and now it's mainstream. I mean, lots of homes are adding solar very quickly. How do you think the path looks like for geothermal? Is it going to be similar to solar, or is it going to be the sort of thing where there'll be a different path to mass adoption?
We borrowed very extensively from solar and productizing geothermal. One example of that is the way we sell the product, by showing customers, here's how much money you'll save over the lifetime of this product, and here's why it's a good financial decision for you, instead of just trying to sell the heating system without even looking at that, right? It's an economic sale for us. We borrowed the financing from solar, so we let people finance the system so they're not laying out a bunch of cash up front if they don't want to. I would say two of the key ways that geothermal is different from solar, in my opinion. One is, when you put solar on your roof, your experience of using electricity does not change. Like, you turn on the lights, they go on. It's like not possible to tell inside the house if you have solar or not. And that is very different for geothermal. If you have an oil furnace or a natural gas furnace or propane furnace, the experience of owning and maintaining and using that system is very different than the experience of using a geothermal heat pump. I mean, one of the ways is that geothermal does heating and cooling. So some of our customers just don't have central air conditioning before they install our system. Another way is just, you're literally not combusting a fuel inside your house, which is something a lot of us do without worrying about it. But I think in the future, when people look back, that will seem like a weird thing to do.
So obviously geothermal is, you know, it's a very different product experience from, you know, burning fuel inside your house. And it's much better for the environment. But how much better for the environment is a geothermal system than what you're typically replacing?
Going from an oil furnace to a geothermal heating and cooling system is the equivalent to taking 39 cars off the road for a whole year. So each home that switches over, that's 39 cars that won't be driving for a year's worth of emission savings.
That's incredible. So what other innovations do you think are coming for geothermal systems? And what role do you think Dandelion will play in kind of bringing those to the market?
Dandelion's doing a lot of work just to understand and measure heat flows in and out of the ground to homes. And so as we get more and more sophisticated at understanding and modeling these flows, we're able to design those ground loops to be less and less expensive. And I think this will be a huge source of cost reduction.
So I'm just curious, how did you know that it was time to kind of, you know, leave the Google nest, as it were, and start off on your own? And what did you learn when you were, you know, a new startup without kind of all these resources? Like, how did that shape where Dandelion is today?
At that moment, X was figuring out its own identity and sort of like how it wanted to apply Alphabet's domain expertise to these moonshots and what sort of projects it was interested in. And I think it was just very clear that selling heating and cooling systems to homeowners in New York, there's pretty much no overlap between that project and Alphabet's other businesses. And so it wasn't a good fit. Like, it wasn't a natural fit, I guess. It would have had to be a force fit. And at the same time, it was the style of project that really was ready for commercialization. That's what had attracted me to it. And it was the type of company that you could really build iteratively. You didn't need $1 billion to start installing heat pumps. Like, you could start with a very small amount of money and learn and earn the right to become bigger and bigger over time. And so that's what convinced us ultimately that the right thing to do was for it to be a standalone startup. And then in terms of what I learned when that happened, I mean, it's like, what didn't I learn? What didn't I realize I didn't know? It was just like the rug was totally pulled under from underneath me. And I think that's why one of the qualities that entrepreneurs need to have is the willingness to just do things that you know you don't know how to do. Because all of it is very learnable, but almost no one goes into it with that knowledge already.
What advice would you give to a founder who's starting a business in an industry where they don't have a ton of experience?
Well, one thing that I've noticed is that if you spend 24/7 being obsessed with anything, you actually can gain a lot of knowledge in that area very quickly. So, you know, I've been in the geothermal industry for, I would say, about 4.5 years now, but there aren't that many people in the industry. And like, at this point, I know most of them. And on the one hand, I would just say, dive in, and people actually learn pretty quickly. And you'll be amazed at how much expertise you can build in a short amount of time, provided the right level of dedication. On the other hand, I think one thing that was hard, but that was critical, was at the beginning, when I really had no expertise in geothermal, trying to meet the people who did and differentiate between people who told me things that had very little basis in data and science, in fact, like just people's opinions, right? Closely held opinions, trying to differentiate between that type of person and then people who thought about the problems in a way that I found more helpful.
And how about someone who really wants to start a company but had only been inside of a large organization? Like, what advice would you give to someone like that?
It's totally doable. And my advice would be to be okay with the fact that there's a lot to learn, and no one expects you to be an expert from day one, nor should you expect that of yourself. And just like anything else, practicing helps, right? So I think like we all accept that if you're bad at tennis and then you practice tennis all the time, you'll become good at tennis. And that seems very normal and acceptable. But then I think we don't feel that way about other skills in life, like, you know, becoming more comfortable with ambiguity, or becoming a better manager, or, you know, all of the things that make starting a small company hard. Certainly, this was jumping into the deep end, but that's a really good way to learn how to swim.
Among your many accolades, one is being honored as one of Fast Company's most creative people. And I'm just wondering, how do you nurture your own creativity? And then what do you do at Dandelion to foster big thinking across the entire company?
The way I think about nurturing my creativity is finding this balance between the humility of recognizing that there is wisdom built into the way things are done today, but then also the confidence to question all of those assumptions, because a lot of commonly held assumptions are incorrect. I give my team members a lot of freedom to, I state the problem that we need to solve, but then I give those team members a lot of freedom to, they're the experts, like they're the best positioned to come up with the best solutions. And then I just try to voice my support and excitement about the solutions that seem most promising, and like provide the resources to tracking them down. And I think a lot of what I do is just try to make room for that. Because sometimes like your guess for how to approach a solution isn't going to pan out. And sometimes it will. And like giving people the freedom to run through that process, it's hard to do actually when there's like a million things to do at a startup, but it always pays off in my experience.
So Kathy, you're obviously a really senior and accomplished technical leader. And unfortunately, there just aren't that many women in those types of roles. So what advice would you have for someone who's early in their career and just wants to follow in your footsteps?
One of the things that I'll always be grateful for is when I was at X, one of the leaders there gave me the opportunity to run this seawater fuels project. I was not your typical project leader. I was probably like 20 years younger than the next youngest. I was one of the only women, maybe the only woman project leader at that time. I don't remember. It took me a year, maybe a little bit more, to even get my mind around the fact that it made sense in any way for me to be running this team. That experience is very foundational for me, because I saw that my skills could just be like facilitating and coordinating and empowering that team to do work that was meaningful for X. If more women had examples of models of leadership that valued like creating space for one's team to do excellent work and be creative and be recognized for that work, and sort of just, I help facilitate the team. I figure out what the goals are. I communicate them. I make sure that people have what they need. It's like, there's a lot of service and leadership, and my style, I would say, is more conventionally feminine, if that makes sense, but it's effective. Perhaps my advice would just be, like, I think it's always helpful to find people who you can identify with who are really good at what they do, men or women, because then it just becomes easier to imagine stretching your own skill set into those roles.